The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
In the final part of the series, I follow the ancient Incan trail to the colorful market town of Pisac to see how the local culture is kept alive. Then I'll scale the heights of yet another marvel of Incan engineering, the fortress of Ollantaytambo, before ending the journey in one of the seven new wonders of the world, the lost city of Machu Picchu.
The National Privacy Commission summons telecommunications networks following a spate of spam text messages offering fake jobs.
The Philippine Food and Drug Administration says COVID-19 vaccines may become available to children aged below 12 before the year ends.
Active COVID-19 cases in the Philippines dropped to 18,721, the lowest since June 13, 2020.
And China warns attempts at challenging its sovereignty and interests are doomed to fail.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Dinsai. You're watching Top Story.
The National Privacy Commission has summoned telecommunications networks following a recent spate of spam text messages offering fake jobs. The meeting has been set this week to discuss data protection of the public. Also included in the meeting, e-commerce platforms and banks. The NPC suspects a global syndicate may be behind the scam, since similar incidents are also being reported in other countries.
Hindi ho ito unique no sa Pilipinas according na rin dito sa mga eksperto na ating nakausap no nakasama rin sa natin dito tinutulungan tayo ay nakikita itong scam na ito no maging sa bayan po sa India no sa Malaysia sa Singapore and even I think Taiwan. This is a very elaborate scam. Marami ng pinanggagalingan po yan. Maaari nga po sa iba pong mga database noon na na-breach, yung mga may tinitingnan din ho kami sa dark web ngayon ano na posible ho mga na-dump no ng mga numero no. But again, no marami na ho maaaring panggalingan.
The National Telecommunications Commission meanwhile orders telco companies to send a text blast warning subscribers of text scams that offer fake jobs.
The National Bureau of Investigation says it's unlikely for scammers to gain access to personal information through contact tracing forms used during the pandemic. The NBI says the country has a Data Privacy Act which protects the personal information of Filipinos. The NBI also reminding the public not to entertain suspicious messages.
Experience namin, yung mga scammers na yan, sir, mas mahirap silang kumuha ng mga detalye, personal details ng mga tao pagka directly makikipagkunay ka doon sa nagko-consolidate, for example, yung information natin sa contact tracing. Mas madali ho talaga silang kumuha kasi ho online, madami ho tayong nabibili na mga ano yung mga numbers. Meron ho yan, ganyan. At the same time, yung mga machine ho talaga nagpa-farm ng mga contact details natin, especially yung numbers natin.
Malacanang also expressing concerns over the spate of spam messages. It gives its assurance the Philippine government will continuously monitor the issue. The palace also vows to make sure the National Telecommunications Commission and the National Privacy Commission will resolve the matter.
Pag privacy issue yan, it's always a cause of concern. Not only for the IATF but for government and for the public, syempre. Kaya nandyan po yung NTC and National Privacy. They have their mandate. They know what they must do. And we will continue to monitor them in the performance of their mandates.
Stop victimizing online delivery riders. That appeal coming from Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo after scammers placed orders worth more than 800,000 pesos for delivery to her office. In a statement, Robredo said she was in meetings when the incident happened Monday afternoon. She then thanked delivery app MetroMart and other merchants for facilitating the return of the goods. Aside from Robredo, her running mate, Senator Francis Pangilinan, also received a message notifying him about a delivery of frozen meat and wine worth 90,000 pesos. Senator Riza Ontiveros also says a scammer used her name and office address to order from a local business.
Philippine lawmakers from the Macabayan bloc seek a probe into the Chinese Coast Guard's use of water cannons against Filipino resupply boats. The lawmakers filed a resolution urging Congress to condemn and investigate the incident as it supposedly shows China's increasing aggression in claiming Philippine waters and territories. Meanwhile, authorities say government forces successfully brought fresh supplies to troops stationed at Ayungin Shoal on Tuesday. That move was aborted last week following the water cannon incident.
China warns attempts at challenging its sovereignty and interests are doomed to fail. Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Zhao Lijian made that statement during a press conference When asked about President Duterte's remarks on the Chinese Coast Guard's recent harassment of Philippine vessels, Duterte had said he abhors that incident, adding the 2016 Hague ruling that invalidated Beijing's claims to the South China Sea points to a just and fair solution to disputes. But Zhao insisted the arbitral ruling is illegal, null and void. He also claimed, quote, the relevant sea areas in the South China Sea are in general tranquil.
Fishers Group of Malacaya insists President Duterte's recent remark condemning the water cannon attack in the Ayungi Shoal came too little too late. The group says Duterte's statement was more of a salvation of his political interest than an assertion of national sovereignty. It also points out China has already transformed most parts of the Philippines' exclusive economic zone into military bases. But Malacañang rejects Pamalakaya's allegations.
TFA acted swiftly. The president spoke about the issue. Ang resupply boats po natin ay nakarating sa Ayungin Shoal.
The late dictator's son, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., submits a negative drug test result to authorities. That's as President Rodrigo Duterte doubles down on his claims about a presidential candidate supposedly using cocaine. Marcos said he took a cocaine test Monday, and the negative result was submitted this morning to the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency, the Philippine National Police, and the National Bureau of Investigation. Marcos, also confident he's not the one being alluded to in Duterte's recent tirades. During a speech in General Santos City on Monday, Duterte stood by his allegations about an unnamed presidential candidate whom he said was a cocaine user.
Totoo yan. There's a candidate who was using cocaine. And you can ask yung mga mayaman. And sabi ng police, bakit hindi natin hinuli? Bakit hindi mo hinuli, Presidente? Hindi mo alam ang mga mayaman. They go on yate or in the air. Doon yan sila magsop-sop ng ano nila. If you do not believe it, well, leave it that way. Basta sinabi ko, do not let it not be said later on that I did not tell you.
Philippine Justice Secretary Bernardo Guevara leaves it up to the police and the anti-drug agency to look into Duterte's claims. But he said the investigation bureau will be on standby if needed.
Malacañang does not need or does not see the need to require presidential and vice presidential candidates to undergo drug testing. Acting presidential spokesperson Carlo Nograles says it's up to the contenders if they want to do so.
That's voluntary. Even if hindi siya kasama sa mga requirements for candidates, whether presidential, vice presidential, senator, or kung anumang position, it's purely voluntary at nasa kanila po yun kung magpa-voluntary drug test sila. Para isa publiko na sila ay drug-free, then it's entirely up to these candidates po.
Nograles also refutes allegations the Duterte administration's drug war is only targeting the poor. He asserts law enforcement officers were able to arrest high-value targets during their previous operations.
Economic issues remain top of mind of voters in the upcoming polls, according to recent surveys. But as RG Cruz tells us, an expert believes, it will all come down to a battle of personalities.
Sammy Lagman has been selling mango shake near the Batasan Pambansa. It's his means of livelihood to support his kids and his parents, which has become harder due to the pandemic. Sammy dreams of a better life, which is why he keeps carrying on despite the hardships.
Unang-una, kailangan medyo makaluwag ako sa buhay para ang mabigyan ko naman kinabukasan ng aking pamilya. Na yun ang pangarap ko. Ligtas kami sa sakit. At saka sa ano man sakuna, sana gabayan kami ni Lord. At nagsusumikap naman kami tulong-tulong para sa pamilya.
His story seems to be the story of many Filipinos. Based on three polls done by PulseAsia, inflation topped the most urgent national concerns on the years before the 2022 elections and two other elections prior. Analysis by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group on polls done by PulseAsia back in September 2021, December 2015, and October 2009, months before presidential elections, shows that the urgent national concerns have stayed the same for the last 18 years. That's inflation, income inequality, alleviation of poverty, job creation, and graft and corruption. For this expert, it only goes to show there has been no significant change from several years ago.
Before the pandemic, while the economy has been growing, it has not trickled down to most Filipinos such that they still felt that they needed to have a better job, to have a better livelihood. They probably have a job already, but they feel that they need to work more to augment their income.
This year's poll, however, showed curbing the pandemic landed in near third place behind inflation and income inequality. For PulseAsia President Ronald Holmes, the pandemic is part of the larger issue of the economy. But curbing graft and corruption also remains a concern. Human rights in the context of the war on drugs and sovereignty in the West Philippine Sea among voters. Holmes also points out candidates tend to say the same things when asked to address the country's concerns.
They will all say that they will attend to these issues. The only difference is really in terms of the strategies. So it would be detrimental to anyone who is running for president to be against a specific position vis-a-vis this issue.
Which is why it will still come down to a battle of personalities.
Pare-pareho lang ang posisyon ng mga kandidato. Doon sa pinagkaiba nila sa panahon na noon ng botante, yun ang pagbabatayan ng botante sa kanyang desisyon. Isa lang posisyon nila at pare-pareho sila. It might be the personality of the candidate rather than their stance on issues. You cannot preclude the possibility that voters basically favor a candidate based on their perception that this candidate would do well or that this candidate appears to be much more authentic or genuine compared to the other candidates.
Or whoever connects with as many people.
Ang unang pagbabataya ng kanilang connection sa kandidato ay kung pareho sila, and ito yung napapatunayan ng mga dating mga pag-aaral, kung pare-pareho silang pinanggalingan in terms of yung ethno-linguistic group. So kung pare-pareho silang nagsasalta ng Bisaya, kung Ilocano, Bicolano, may inclinasyon na iboboto nila. Yung kapareho nilang pinanggalingan, yung geographical o yung ethno-linguistic ties na sinasabi.
Holmes says that a battle of personalities cannot be avoided because the country's political system is candidate-centered, where it's a matter of who instead of what policies earn the most number of votes. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The camp of presidential aspirant Manny Pacquiao, meanwhile, acknowledges the issues of voters have not changed over the years. The chairman of Pacquiao's Promdi party says what needs to change are the solutions being presented by each candidate. He also brushed off Pacquiao's poor showing in voter preference surveys.
Traditionally, you also don't want your candidate to be top rating in the beginning. You want him to peak at a later stage. You've seen this in historical elections in the past. So there's the political strategy, and then there are individual tactics. It's getting people to understand. It's how to translate and explain it in such a way that they can understand. And the surveys, I mean, I've done my own analysis of the surveys. It's not perfect.
Labor leader Leody de Guzman's platform of government and the alliance he has forged with various sectoral groups will help him win the presidency in 2022. That's according to Sonny Melencio, the chairman of the Partido Lakas ng Masa, which is carrying the Guzman's candidacy. Melencio says while other candidates also promise to solve poverty and joblessness this pandemic, the Guzman is the only one who has concretely laid out his economic recovery program and how he aims to fund it.
And we have formed several coalitions of people's organizations, trade unions, social movements, at itong mga plataforma na aming binuo ay nanggaling dyan. So alam namin na ito ilalaban namin sa Kongreso, ilalaban namin sa Executive, ilalaban namin sa kalye. Hindi kami titigil hanggat hindi nakukuha ang mga ito. Marami kasing pangako eh, pero saan kukunin ang pera? Kami nag-push na ng platform na kunin natin yan sa wealth tax doon sa mayayaman. Sa at least yung 300 families lang, at 3% na sa kanilang network, we can get a trillion pesos na magagamit natin for all the social projects that we need to do.
Former Police Chief Guillermo Eleazar vows to strengthen the police force's internal affairs service if he wins a Senate seat next year. The IAS was envisioned to be an independent and autonomous unit within the PNP dedicated to investigating erring policemen. It's the same agency that gave the Justice Department access to documents of dozens of drug war operations that have resulted in the death of suspects. But it has yet to submit thousands more cases for review.
Dapat meron siyang sort of independence, mas malaking budget na separate para sa kanila. Okay. At hindi lang siya yung recommendatory na yung IAS maging disciplinary authority din sila. Na ang power nila is hindi basta-basta na influence ng PNP.
Social media is expected to play a huge role in the 2022 elections, especially amid a raging pandemic. Ina Reformina gives us a rundown of the rules set by the Philippine poll body on online campaigning.
19-year-old Jenny Cole, a student, checks news about the upcoming May 2022 elections, as well as the latest on aspiring candidates on her mobile phone via social media platforms.
Through social media po kasi makikilala po natin yung ibang nagka-candidate na for election po. Para dun po mas makikita po nila yung mga ginagawa nila.
In the latest We Are Social Worldwide report released in January this year, mobile connections in the Philippines have reached a staggering 152.4 million, more than the country's 110 million population. 73.91 million, or 67% of the population, are internet users, and 89 million, or 80.7%, are active on social media. The Philippines also had the most time spent on the internet and social media, which is why University of the Philippines Diliman Political Science Department Professor Aris Arugay says candidates will take advantage of social media campaigning, especially amid the still raging pandemic.
They're highly flexible because unlike TV or radio ads wherein they have to be played in prime time to get more mileage, this can all be blasted on social media on a regular basis. And this could be done automatically. It's highly iterative, paulit-ulit. It's highly clandestine, given the relative lack of regulatory infrastructure.
The Philippine Election Commission has released the implementing rules for the Fair Election Act in the 2022 polls, including online campaigning and social media. All verified official accounts, websites, blogs, and other social media pages of political parties and candidates, which will be used to upload political ads and other election propaganda, must be registered with the COMELEC. Only verified accounts and websites shall be used in online campaigning. Digital influencers and online content creators who will be hired to post and upload election propaganda must submit a detailed report of the agreement and transaction to the COMELEC. The poll body admits while online and social media campaigning are covered by the allowable spending limits and must be included in the required statement of contribution and expenditures, or SOCE, there is no law regulating the frequency of a poll ad post and upload.
Yung spending limit is still the same spending limit for all candidates. Ang walang limit sa social media ay yung frequency, yung dalas ng labas. For example, sa print, you can only print ads on a paper 3 times a week. Ganyan. Sa media, you can only use so many minutes of advertising time. Walang ganyang limitation sa social. So sa social, because there's no law.
Candidates will be permitted to hold live streams of e-rallies, which will not be deducted from their broadcast airtime limits. Aside from strict observance of health protocols, candidates must submit to the COMELEC a recording of their e-rallies. They may accept virtual gifts from supporters, but giving away gifts to their audience is prohibited. The COMELEC will sponsor free live streaming rallies for national candidates when the official campaign period for national posts begins on February 8. 3 presidential and vice presidential bets, 5 senatorial candidates, and 10 party list groups will be featured per night. The rule on campaign posters is the same as previous elections, and motorcades are still allowed. TV and radio airtime limits for national and local positions have also not changed, as well as rules on radio and tabloid election propaganda. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
On this day, 12 years ago, the bodies of 57 people riddled with bullets were found on a hilly site in Maguindanao. Some of them were buried along with the vehicles they were riding in the worst election-related incident in recent Philippine history. The Maguindanao massacre is also considered the single deadliest event for journalists around the world. The convoy was on its way for the filing of the Certificate of Candidacy of then-gubernatorial candidate Ismael Mangudadato. In December 2019, a Quezon City court convicted 5 of the 7 principal suspects accused of murder, all belonging to the powerful Ampatuan clan. But the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines says the quest for justice is still on.
It was really a tragedy waiting to happen, no? Given the political situation in the Philippines. And even today, warlords and political dynasties still reign. So it's really a challenge for journalists to continue doing their job without fear or without being tempted by politicians. So dalawa lang naman lagi yung tactics nila eh, either to intimidate you or to buy you, no? During elections. So we still continue to be vigilant, and of course we do not want a repeat of the Ampatuan massacre. So we continue campaigning for justice.
Up next, the Philippines logs over 1,100 new COVID-19 cases.
And Philippine drug regulators say COVID vaccines may become available to children aged below 12 before the year ends. More news when we return.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. The number of active COVID-19 infections in the Philippines further going down. It's now at 18,721, which is the lowest since June 13, 2020. This after the country reported 2,000 more recoveries. 195 more deaths have also been recorded. Meanwhile, the country logs 1,153 new cases. The 2.3% positivity rate reported today is the second lowest since testing data became available in April 2020.
The Philippine Food and Drug Administration says COVID-19 vaccines may become available to children aged below 12 before the year ends. No vaccine maker has applied for emergency use authorization of their jabs to children aged 5 to 11 yet. But the FDA says Pfizer and Sinovac are already preparing the requirements needed in applying for an EUA.
The 5 to 12-year-old vaccines, I think by Pfizer, we hope that they will be sending in their application for an EUA very soon. Nagtanong na sila, and they already asked for the list of requirements, and they told us that they are completing the requirements. No? Meron lang kasi atang difference konti dun sa formulation ng vaccine for children. So it's going to be a very, it's like a new EUA, no? Kasi medyo may bagong innovation do sa product. But other than that, ang Sinovac din, hinihintay namin na mag-submit ulit ng data nila for children na below, ano, parang below 18 years old. They just want have to complete some more data to give to our vaccine experts. And we hope to get that soon.
Some countries, including the U.S., have begun rolling out Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine to children as young as 5 years old.
U.S.-based drug makers Merck and Ridgeback Biotherapeutics calling for volunteer patients in the Philippines for the clinical trial of their oral anti-COVID pill, molnupiravir. The Philippines is part of the global study of the potentially game-changing drug. The phase 3 of the trial here at home will begin this month. As a global study of molnupiravir continues, it is currently allowed for use in several Philippine hospitals, which have received a compassionate special permit from regulators. It is also now available through the Office of the Vice President's Telemedicine Program. The OVP signed a memorandum of agreement with Qualimed Health Network to distribute the pill to patients with a prescription. Qualimed is one of the facilities which was granted the compassionate special permit.
More universities expected to welcome back students in the coming months. Commission on Higher Education Chairman Prospero De Vera says most of them will be reopening by January as universities are opting to start limited face-to-face classes in the next semester. De Vera adds some may already open up by next month as long as they can comply with the new guidelines. So far, there are around 160 schools that have already begun holding limited face-to-face classes after health measures eased due to higher vaccination rates and lower COVID cases.
Kailangan bakunado ang mga papasok na mga estudyante at mga faculty. Ikalawa, kailangan yung requirements ng minimum health standards ay nandoon sa eskwelahan. Kailangan naka-retrofit yung facilities nila. At pang-apat, kailangan may coordination or concurrence ng local government. Pinag-aaralan namin kung paano mapapabilis ito. Baka naman doon sa mga school na ready na talaga, gumawa na lang ng self-assessment. Nagko-consultation kami na sa mga schools kung ano yung pinakamabisang paraan para mapabilis yung pagbubukas ng klase. No?
Overseas, the U.S. issues a travel warning on Germany and Denmark due to rising COVID-19 cases there. Several European countries are seeing infection surges, with cases soaring to record highs. Austria on Monday became the first country in Western Europe to reimpose a full lockdown. Other countries are expected to follow suit with new restrictions and vaccine mandates.
Palestinians in Bethlehem hope more tourists will flock to the city this Christmas season as Israel eases its COVID curbs for foreign tourists. This report.
The trickle of tourists is sometimes scarcely enough to fill a manger, let alone an inn. But Bethlehem's Palestinians are hopeful that numbers will rise in the month before Christmas. The traditional birthplace of Jesus was all but shuttered by the global health crisis last year, ravaging the tourism-dependent economy and leading some hoteliers to consider selling up. Souvenir shop owner Fadi Banan is trying to stay optimistic.
I would encourage everyone to come and visit the Holy Land. It's the time, it's the right time to come. Okay, a lot of groups are coming, they're starting to come. Everything is safe and we are ready. We are ready for that.
This year, Israel has eased curbs on foreign tourists in time for Christmas.
Because of the COVID, we couldn't travel, but now God has let us travel here to Bethlehem, and it's really special for us.
While grateful for the return of some foreign tourists and Christian Palestinians from the West Bank and Israel, it's still a far cry from the 3.5 million visitors who came in winter 2019. Bethlehem's municipality scaled back the town's Christmas market last year and banned most spectators from the tree lighting ceremony. This year's celebration will proceed as normal on December 4th, with visitors asked to wear masks.
The PSE index becomes the best performer in Asia on Tuesday as it shrugs off volatility from U.S. President Joe Biden's decision to renominate Fed Chair Jerome Powell. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets traded mixed on Tuesday after U.S. President Joe Biden reappointed Fed Chair Jerome Powell to a second four-year term, reinforcing expectations the U.S. will taper its stimulus soon. Philippine shares outperformed with the PSE index jumping 1.6% or 118 points to climb back above 7,400. BDO Capital's Ed Francisco says the markets should appreciate the continuity in Fed leadership.
We are slowly decoupling, but of course when they sneeze, we still catch a cold, but at least it's not pneumonia anymore, right? So that's good. And hey, rates have already started to go up, but even our central bank and Governor Diokno has said he's gonna be accommodative still to our borrowers because loan growth is starting to come back already, which is good, right? And that's the signal that the economy is, reviving. Well, the index anyway is done well, right? And that's why we are sort of lingering today at the 7,200 level. We will just wait for more good news. People have taken profits, but there's still room to grow.
Francisco sees the index easily hitting 7,400 to 7,500 levels by year end. This used to be their best case. Now it's the group's base case as companies fire on all four cylinders again. In corporate stories, STI Holdings posts an 18% increase in its enrollment for school year 2021 to 2022. Its Bacolod campus registered the largest enrollment increase. This even as classes continue to be fully online. For the period, the company managed to narrow losses to 116.7 million from 203 million net loss previously. Meanwhile, Lucky Me noodle maker Mondanisin is changing the use of its IPO proceeds of around 7.1 billion pesos, previously earmarked to expand capacity of its meat alternative business. It will now be used for brand building, R&D, influencer partnerships, and new process capabilities. The company says this should help strengthen its position as a global leader in the meat alternative business. Mondanisin went public in June, raising some 49 billion pesos, making it the biggest IPO in Philippine history. And finally, the Aboitiz Group reaffirms its commitment to the Davao region, with Group President and CEO Sabine Aboitiz saying they will continue to pour investments there. Speaking at the 6th Davao Investment Conference, Aboitiz also lauded government efforts to build essential infrastructure, reduce crime, and market the region as a safe and attractive destination for investors and tourists. He urges government to be aggressive in attracting investments, saying, "If we are too passive about incentivizing investments, we run the risk of being overtaken by our competitors in the Asia-Pacific region who are doing everything they can to drive investors in their direction." Among the group's investments there, Davao Light and Power, which it bought back in 1946, power generation through HEDCOR, Therma South, and Therma Marine, as well as the Apo Agua Infrastructure Bulk Water Supply Project. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The COVID-19 pandemic upended businesses, leaving thousands unemployed and forcing many workers to improve, sometimes learn new skills as the health crisis accelerated the shift to digitalization. But as Warren De Guzman tells us, while Filipinos are eager to upskill, there are some familiar roadblocks along the way.
The K-pop phenomenon has pervaded the Philippines and the rest of the world, and new data suggest it even influenced online learning decisions. Based on data from New York Stock Exchange-listed Coursera, 2 out of the top 10 most popular online courses in the Philippines from October 2020 to September 2021 were on learning the Korean language.
I think that's a K-pop phenomenon. So I think a lot of people come to Coursera because they want to understand the lyrics. But I look at the courses, and there's definitely a lot of overlap in terms of the globally most popular courses and those that are most popular in the Philippines. It might be a little bit hidden under there, but Programming for Everybody is really one of our most popular courses from University of Michigan on basically programming in Python.
The most popular Coursera courses in the world are mostly connected to cloud computing, data analytics, and social media marketing, required skills for nearly all businesses looking to keep up with the rapidly digitizing global economy. The Duterte administration's economic managers and the largest business organizations in the Philippines have all been saying the upskilling of the Philippines needs to happen swiftly to help Filipinos find and keep work amid the so-called fourth industrial revolution. Coursera data show Filipinos have been making progress, and the Philippines now has the third highest learner growth rate worldwide at 85%. Coursera adds 12 businesses, including the Ayala Group, and over 60 campuses, including the University of the Philippines, alongside the Department of Science and Technology, have all partnered with Coursera to help address the lack of IT and science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, or STEM courses, in the Philippines. The DOST says it fully expects to continue its partnership with Coursera to help give more Filipinos the necessary skills to survive.
Our partnership with Coursera, which started in 2020, is like seeing a rainbow in the middle of a dark storm.
Aside from Coursera, there are many other foreign companies already in the Philippines working to help upskill Filipino talent, including China's Huawei, which partnered with the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry for the innovation center it inaugurated earlier this year, and Tata Consultancy Services of India, which partnered with the Department of Education to train high school students. TCS says Filipino students are talented but have limited options.
Of course, ang pinakamalaking challenge namin most definitely is the internet connectivity, because of course when we run this in Cordillera, it's a mountainous area, no? So isa talaga siya sa naging issue. Kaya namin siya ginawa in the morning, because usually in the afternoon hindi na maayos yung internet connection ng area.
The Department of Education says it will continue with programs such as the Go IT program in partnership with TCS to help provide more learning options to Filipinos. The program has now moved from Cordillera to Western Visayas, with 1,000 student participants from just under 300 in the previous year. Both the government and private sector are hoping more partnerships will materialize to help improve education as well as telecommunications across the Philippines. As of September, there are 4.25 million unemployed Filipinos based on government data. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
Over in the U.S., the Energy Department is reportedly set to release national reserves of crude oil in coordination with other countries. That's according to a Biden administration official, after Washington failed to persuade the Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries and its allies to pump more oil and help bring down gasoline prices across the world. U.S. President Joe Biden has asked China, India, South Korea, and Japan for a coordinated oil stocks release as his approval ratings slump ahead of next year's congressional elections. The threat of a coordinated release, along with new COVID lockdowns in Europe, has knocked the wind out of crude oil's rally. Brent crude was last trading at $79.30 a barrel, down by more than $7 from its peak in late October.
The International Monetary Fund strikes a cautious tone over Bitcoin. The lender warns El Salvador not to use a cryptocurrency as legal tender amid the risks related to it. It notes Bitcoin's high price volatility could have significant risks to consumer protection and financial stability. The IMF also claims its use gives rise to fiscal contingent liabilities. In September, El Salvador became the first country to adopt Bitcoin as legal tender. A few days ago, the country's leader also announced plans to build the world's first Bitcoin city, which will be funded initially by Bitcoin bonds. But some residents there have protested the use of the cryptocurrency.
In other news, the U.S. House panel investigating the deadly January 6th attack at the Capitol has issued subpoenas to more allies of former President Trump. Here's the full story.
The U.S. House committee investigating the January 6th Capitol riot said on Monday it had subpoenaed Alex Jones and Roger Stone. Jones founded the right-wing website InfoWars, and Stone is a close ally of former President Donald Trump. Stone said in a statement he had not yet seen the subpoena, adding, quote, "I had no advance knowledge of the events that took place at the Capitol on that day." A mob of Trump supporters stormed the Capitol earlier this year in a failed attempt to block congressional approval of his election loss to Democrat Joe Biden. The committee is scrutinizing Trump's actions relating to those events. Nearly 700 people have been charged for taking part in the riot. Four others were also issued in the latest subpoenas, including a Trump spokesperson and right-wing political activists Dustin Stockton and his fiancée Jennifer Lawrence. They did not immediately respond to requests for comment. The committee has now issued more than three dozen subpoenas and received testimony from more than 200 witnesses. Another Trump ally, Steve Bannon, was indicted earlier this month on two counts of contempt of Congress for defying a subpoena from the House committee.
South Korea's former dictator Chun Doo-hwan, who ruled the country with an iron fist in the 80s, has passed away. We have this report.
Former South Korean President Chun Doo-hwan has died at the age of 90, his former press aide said on Tuesday. A former military commander, Chun seized power in the coup of 1979 and then ruled the country with an iron fist. He presided over the 1980 Gwangju army massacre of pro-democracy demonstrators. He was later charged with mutiny, treason, and was arrested after refusing to appear at the prosecutor's office and fleeing to his hometown. During his trial in the mid-1990s, he defended the coup as necessary to save the nation from a political crisis and denied sending troops into Gwangju. In what was dubbed the trial of the century by local media, Chun was later found guilty of mutiny, treason, and bribery and sentenced to death. In their verdict, judges said Chun's rise to power came through illegal means which inflicted enormous damage on the people. The ruling was, however, commuted by Seoul's High Court in recognition of Chun's role in the fast-paced economic development of the country and the peaceful transfer of the presidency in 1988. But his story didn't end there, and he made several returns to the spotlight. In 2003, he sparked outrage when he claimed he had assets of just around $245 in cash, two dogs, and home appliances, despite owing over $185 million in fines. Last year, he was also found guilty for defaming a late democracy activist and Catholic priest in his 2017 memoirs.
Marvel's newest animated series, Hitmonkey, has swung into action and offered viewers a darker version of the comic book universe. Our correspondent, Yong Chavez, talks to one of the show stars in this report.
The new Marvel animated TV series Hitmonkey stars George Takei, Olivia Munn, Ally Mackie, and Nobi Nakanishi. It features the voice of Ted Lasso himself, Jason Sudeikis, and Fred Tatasciore in the title role. Ally Mackie plays Haruka, an honest cop from a Japanese small town who moved to the big city.
What made this project special for you?
It just was a whole new thing, and it was so exciting to be able to really go there. I had scenes where I was tearing up, or other scenes where we just had so much fun and we could really like take it to those gritty places. So I had such a blast.
When she was a young girl, Mackie did voiceovers for video games and at 14 moved to Los Angeles to join an all-girl band. She recalls going to auditions at a time when casting directors and filmmakers did not consider Asian talents for major roles.
I don't think I realized how much it took a toll on me until I was an adult. And then looking back, I felt really sad for my 14-year-old self who did go through all of this, who tried to fit into all of these little tiny boxes that I felt like you know, society wanted me to be. And it was very freeing as an adult to be able to say, no, like, I'm undefinable. I don't need to fit into any boxes. But it was certainly a struggle. Like, I took a lot of from auditions into my own personal life, which I think was hard, of feeling like, oh, well, I don't matter. You know, my story doesn't matter. And that's what's sad about representation, is when you're not the central figure of any story, you start to feel like your own personal life doesn't matter. So that's why I'm so excited about Asian American people, especially women, playing leads, because then, you know, it basically shows young girls that you are the hero of your story. You do matter.
The first season of Marvel's hit Monkey is now streaming on Hulu. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
Oscar-winning actress Halle Berry makes her directorial debut in the film Bruised, in which she also plays the lead character. Take a look.
Yo, that's Jackie Justice, right? She used to be famous.
The film Bruised tells the story of a washed-up mixed martial arts fighter attempting a comeback. And for the film's star, Oscar-winning actress Halle Berry, Bruised marked her debut in the director's chair.
Oh, I knew it was going to be hard. I knew it was going to be the hardest thing I had ever done.
You used to be Jackie Justice.
Still am.
Berry said it took several years to get the movie to the screen, including intense physical training to prepare for fight scenes.
When this script came along, I finally found a piece that really fit for me. I understood every aspect of all of these characters, this world. I loved the fight game since I was a little girl. I was a huge fan of MMA when this script came my way. So it felt like this is something I really knew, and I loved enough for this to be my debut.
After decades in the entertainment industry and winning an Oscar for the 2001 film Monsters Ball, Berry said people are often surprised that she still finds the entertainment industry tough to navigate.
You know, I get that most people would think, oh, that somehow it's easy for me. But also, I think there's enough people that also know it's still hard for women and women of color to do anything in this industry. And no matter how many accolades I've racked up over the years or how many films I've done, as a Black woman, the struggle is real. It's still real. You know, nothing has ever been given to me in my entire career, and I still have to fight for things. And while sometimes I wish I didn't have to, I'm also grateful that I can.
This is about to be the greatest story never told.
The film is currently playing in a limited number of theaters and will be released on Netflix on Wednesday.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually